because I always fear it gives undue attention to the enemy. And I don't like to give him free advertising. But on the other hand, it's important that people be aware of the spiritual reality that we live in, that exists, that encompasses the world, encompasses the universe. And so in this talk tonight, which was born essentially out of an increased awareness, I think, in the church's ministry of exorcism, brought out by a movie that was released not long ago called The Rite, and also an increase in, I guess, what I would call the occult, New Age, and in different expressions of Satanism that is increasing. What do I mean by that? I recently went to a chapters here and went to the Christianity section. There is only one book that I would give a total 2 thumbs up in terms of Catholicism within that section. But next to it, in the witchcraft, parapsychology, New Age, there were throngs and throngs of books. So what I propose to do is to give a kind of general outline of what I do, what the topic is that I'm talking about in terms of defining it and so forth, and then applying it with some specific cases that I'll inform you about. And then afterwards, depending upon time, we'll conclude with some question and answers. Now, the thing to be aware in terms of the enemy is that the enemy, by virtue of the sin of Adam, Adam and Eve bit the fruit of the forbidden tree. But the sin was Adam's, it wasn't Eve's. The covenant had been made with Adam. It is for that reason in the writings of the church you see a reference to the sin of Adam, but you don't see a reference to the sin of Adam and Eve. So Adam did something which changed the nature of the universe. And in that action of disobedience, in which he chose to put his faith in the lies of the devil, as opposed to the words of God, what he did was surrender the covenant to the enemy. What does that mean? It means by that action, the devil became the prince of the world. Now, we find even our Lord Jesus saying that in the New Testament. He became the prince. What does that mean? It means that when we're born, we don't belong to God. When we're born, we don't even belong to ourselves or to our parents, properly speaking. We belong to the enemy. And for that reason, Christ instituted baptism in order to remove that original injustice, that original death, if you will. Baptism is a reclaiming of a person for God. Without baptism, one cannot be a Christian, properly speaking. Baptism is that sacrament by which we become members of Christ's body. How is it that we can be a member of his body? Well, if we share the same spirit as Jesus, then we have the same body. In the universe that emerged after the fall of Adam and Eve, through the sin of Adam, what happened is there was a kind of destruction of three relationships, where they weren't actually totally destroyed, but they were severely wounded. Our relationship with God was wounded greatly. God used to walk in the garden with Adam and Eve, says the book of Genesis. He no longer does that, or he no longer did that after the fall of Adam. The relationships between humans and among humans, the relationship between Adam and Eve was changed. They were now ashamed of one another. And they felt the need to cover themselves. And the third relationship that was damaged was the relationship of ourselves to ourselves, Self-hatred emerged out of the fall of Adam and Eve due to the sin of Adam. We're too short, we're too tall, we're too fat, we're too thin, we're too smart, we're too dumb, we're too this, we're too that. I've screwed up, I've made mistakes, I've done things that have hurt people, wounded people, and I'm a monster. These are the kinds of things that people, most people, recite in one form or another at regular intervals in their life. This is a direct effect of that fall. And in that fall, the lordship of God was surrendered to the enemy. Now, I'm going to flesh this out with an example. During the rite of baptism, there's an anointing that precedes the actual pouring of the water. And we call that the anointing with the oil of catechumens. Now, that is not the original name for that oil. That oil is called the oil of exorcism. And what is an exorcism? An exorcism is a solemn prayer, petition to the Lord to free somebody from the power of the enemy. Actually, it includes even more than that. There can be a place under the power of an enemy. There could be an animal or a thing under the power of the enemy. And an exorcism releases or liberates each one of those things from the enemy's power. During that rite, the rite of the anointing, which in actually the book that the priests read, it calls the prayer that goes along with that anointing the prayer of exorcism. You never get to see that, but that's what it is. There's a good priest friend of mine that his instructor in the seminary was performing a baptism once. This was in California. And there was a family, the family that brought the baby forward to be baptized, one of the members of the family, who happened to be the godfather of the baby, he was in the mafia. So he was a professional criminal. When the priest went and placed his thumb on the oil and then traced the sign of the cross on the chest of the baby, in other words, applying the oil of exorcism, that godfather, that man who was involved in the mafia, flipped up in the air, landed on the altar on his knees, had his hands up, and started to howl like a wolf. That is the power behind the oil of exorcism. We haven't even got to the part of the pouring of the water. Obviously, somebody else had to serve as godfather that day. But this is the kind of thing, the kind of battle that emerges. An action going on over here, and the enemy feels it over there. The action of Christ is very strong. And he came, according to 1 John chapter 3, verses 8, the reason for the Son of God, that the Son of God appeared, was to destroy the works of the devil. That's how the Apostle John puts it in his first epistle. So, what does the work of deliverance and exorcism involve? Most people think that if when somebody is under the power of the enemy, the power of the evil one, that the priest comes with some type of book, reads some prayers, and it's as if he sprinkled some magic god dust over the person, and whatever was harassing them left. That is not the case at all. People come under the power of the enemy due to poor relationships, generally speaking. They choose to associate with something, usually something sinful, and that gets them jurisdiction with the enemy. So, at your baptism, you're reclaimed for God. You are a member of the body of Christ, and you are free from the tyranny of the devil. Doesn't mean you're free of temptation your whole life, because even our Lord was tempted, but you're free from his direct dominion. Through a mortal sin, through a sin that is grave, is serious, done with full knowledge and deliberate consent, the effects of our baptism are lost. The effects are lost, meaning that the Holy Spirit can no longer dwell in us. We have separated ourselves from God through the mortal sin. Guess who we belong to then? We belong to the enemy. That original act of justice that Jesus instituted in baptism gets reversed. And we are now under the power of the evil one again. And why does he want us? He wants us because he wants to prove God wrong. God's desire was to make flesh and blood creatures, humans, partake in his divinity through a sharing of his spirit. He wanted to dwell with human beings. The devil and his angels, his fallen angels, rebelled against that thought. They rebelled against it. And they have, through that action, condemned themselves eternally for hell. There is no way out for Satan. People may think, well, isn't that a little bit cruel on the part of God? It's not cruel at all. Satan made an eternal decision, a decision which he makes at every moment of eternity. What he wants to do is take as many souls as he can with him down into where he lives, into hell, in a place that is totally separated from God. When I became a priest, I was already living in Houston, Texas. I had served as a deacon there. And at that time, I became one of the staff priests at the Catholic Charismatic Center. That's where I was stationed. And the Charismatic Center is unique because it's not only the largest church in the city, in the diocese of Galveston, Houston, but it's also one that carries a special mission. All of the requests that come to the Archdiocese for deliverance and exorcism, we get them. So they are given to one of the three priests that are there, myself and two others. Now, I don't want you going away from here saying that I'm an exorcist, because that is a canonical title. In other words, that's a legal title given by the church to someone. I am not a designated exorcist. I am simply doing the work that is available to all priests to do. If there is a case which is very difficult, which no other means of prayer, no other means of petition, no other acts of prayer can break the hold of the enemy, then the bishop is petitioned for permission to use the church's solemn rite of exorcism. We've never had to resort to that. And we've never had to resort to it because the three of us are focused on one thing. What was the act by which this person came under the dominion of the enemy? There has to be a door. The devil exists where he is allowed to exist. The devil influences where he is allowed to influence. And as long as he retains that permission, he has every right to be there, and he will always claim that right. I'll give you an example. How many people here remember the old movie The Exorcist? By William Peter Blatty. It was in the 70s, and it was and remains one of the most popular movies of all time. In that movie, a girl was possessed. Now, that was based somewhat loosely on a real-life case of possession, which involved a boy from St. Louis in the 1950s. And the way that he was possessed, and I have a copy of the original transcript by the Jesuit that was in the room watching the exorcist during each of the exorcism sessions. The action by which that boy came under the dominion of the enemy was his aunt came over, who was babysitting him, and brought a Ouija board. And he was very, very young, had no idea what the Ouija board was, but she invited him to participate with it. And he did. And that gave the enemy a permission. Now, did he explicitly know, this boy, that what he was doing? No, but it doesn't matter. Many of us are under the illusion that they have to specifically, solemnly invite the enemy into their lives or to kind of take control of a passion or a habit that they have. And it's only through that conscious decision that the enemy gets a hold of us. And nothing could be further from the truth. Nothing could be further. Any bad relationship that is of a spiritual nature or of a moral nature, a decision to break a commandment, for example, or a decision to have a relationship with something that is of its nature violent, is of its nature dark, is of its nature against the plan of God for the world, that is a movement towards evil. And that movement will be met with the presence of the enemy at some level or other. Now, that's a lot of theory, and I'm going to flesh this out with an example. I got a call one day from a woman who wanted to have her house blessed. And I said, okay, is there any particular reason? I've learned to ask that. Well, there's stuff happening inside the house. Well, what is happening? Well, we come in, we turn on the lights, we'll walk into the next room, we come back, the lights are off. Several times I've come in, put the car keys on the kitchen counter, turn around to grab a drink from the fridge, and the car keys are now on the kitchen table rather than the counter. They have two little children, they were 5 and 6 years old in the family, and they could see out of the corner of their eye a gray figure emerging out of the room. And when they would look at it, it would kind of disappear. But as time went on, as the months went on, they were able to look at it directly. And it would walk in and out of the children's room as if it owned the place. That's a very common symptom. That's common in the beginning. 4, the little girl had a habit of shaking her leg during her sleep. She had always had the habit of kind of just rocking her leg while she was sleeping. One night, Mom was in bed, and she heard the shaking, but it was different. It was quicker. It was more violent than normal. It had a violent tinge to it. She got out of bed to look into the room, and everything was perfectly still. So she went back to bed. Second time, she went and looked in the room. After hearing it again, everything again was perfectly still. She heard it a third time, went to check. Everything was perfectly still, but from the dark corner of the room, the corner that had no light, she heard a growl. On a separate occasion, Dad had a habit at night sometimes when he was tucking them into bed, tucking the kids in, they slept on a metal bunk bed. The little girl was on the bottom and the boy on the top. And he had a habit of pulling on it and shaking it and doing some horseplay and saying, you know, I'm going to throw this bed across the room and getting them excited and so forth and just having a bit of fun like that. Mom and Dad were in bed one night and they heard the bed shaking and twisting, just like when Dad is doing it. And so they heard the little girl give out a scream. They got up and they ran into the room, turn on the light, and this bed is moving by itself. And the girl is looking for the cause of the movement, looking to see what could be pulling on this bed. From that point, everybody in the family started sleeping in the same room. They were all sleeping in Dad's room. They were all very scared, as you can imagine. The other manifestation that they described was one day Dad was going to work and walking out the front door. He heard the footsteps of what sounded like a child, he was home alone at the time, running towards the back door, opening the door and closing it behind him. Dad went to the back door and looked in the backyard and there was nobody there. They had a fenced-in backyard. So then they give a call to us. And so I told the lady, I said, look, I'll be glad to come over to your house and bless your house, but you have some very strong manifestations going on in your house. And manifestations don't come like we get the cold virus, right? Which we can sometimes seemingly be doing nothing when we catch a cold. That's not how the enemy works. The enemy has a jurisdiction in this family's home, which he is exercising. And so she said to me, how did she word it? It actually astounded me, because most of my work is trying to uncover what's going on in the life of the person. So I spend a long time interviewing them. I want to know where they stand morally. I want to know what their human relationships are and associations and so forth, because that is usually at the bottom of why there's a manifestation. She said, I think I know where the door is, right away. She said, 6 months ago I had an affair with my husband. At the same time, he fell off the wagon and used heavy drugs again. He had been a recovered addict. I said, okay, well, those are two mortal sins. That will do it. That's enough. So I said to her, I'll go over and bless your house, but I want to talk to you and your husband before I do it. I want you to set the whole evening aside. I do not want the children in the room when I talk to you, because they're just too young. But I do want them in the house, because I want them to see me bless the house afterwards. So I made an appointment with them, and when I got there, I asked them, pardon me, it didn't unfold like that. I asked her one more question, where do you go to church? And she said, well, my husband and I were both baptized Catholics. You know there's a but coming here. But 2 years ago, we went to such and such Protestant church. And that ended after a year or so, and we haven't been going anywhere after that. I said, okay. I got their address and so forth. And then what I did was I sat down and I prayed and I asked God, give me a light, give me a knowledge of what is going on here so I can go and address the problem perfectly. And so I asked him, what is the name of the demon that is in their home? And after a while, it came to me. It's the demon of imitation. They turn on the lights, he turns off the lights. They put their car keys here, he puts them over there. The little girl shakes her leg in her sleep. It shakes its leg in its sleep. Dad shakes the bunk bed. It shakes the bunk bed. Dad walks out the front door. It walks out the back door. The demon of imitation. And so it fit their sins perfectly. She left her husband and went after an imitation husband. He left the happiness of his family and went after the happiness that he thought the drugs could give him. They both left the one true church and they went after an imitation church. The demon of imitation. So when I got there, I went through what I call renunciations with him. I explained what I just explained to you. And I said, he's not going to leave because you only think that he's in your house. He's not in your house. You're in his house. I asked them to repeat a series of renunciations. In the name of Jesus, I repent. Having cheated on my husband, in the name of Jesus, I repent. Having taken the drugs. And then afterwards, I asked them how they felt about it. They said, well, Father, you know, it feels good, it's all right, but when is this thing going to leave? I said, well, it's going to leave, and just before I could open my mouth, there was a bang in the room where the children were. It felt like a fridge tipping over, like the whole house shook. Now, the house was a bungalow, it was very small, maybe 900 square feet, very, very small. So the whole house shook. I asked if they had anything in the room that could tip over, and they were in the course of running in to see what was going on, and they came out just as quickly. they couldn't find anything that would have made that bed. Certainly the children who were in the room at the time were too small to tip over anything significant, so there was nothing out of place. Both parents come back, and we go over the whole process by which they need to now not only reject evil, which they did in the renunciation, but now they need to replace that with God. And as I'm leading them through that part, the kids come running out as if with total and complete silliness, with laughing and uncontrollably, and with just kind of making a nuisance. They had been perfectly quiet up to that point. And Dad takes them in the room. At this point, he's getting pretty frustrated. And when he sat down back into his place and he leaned back in his chair, his cell phone came up flying out of his pocket and flew 8 feet in front of him. And he was about to let out a scream. He had clenched his fist. And I looked at him and I said, "I'm going to call him Michael. Michael, what you need to do is focus on me. In a few minutes, this is all going to be history, provided that you do what I tell you to do." And so he followed through with his renunciations and claiming Jesus as his Lord and Savior, and committed, recommitted to going to church, to pursuing the seven sacraments, and to allowing the Lord to be the Lord of his life. They never had another manifestation after that. So when they were done, I blessed the house, I took holy water around, and that was it. There was no more manifestations. At this point, I'm going to stop and see if anyone has any questions. No questions? I knew you'd ask the first one. Can the door be generational? Very good question. Demons live in wounds. There are two sources for the wounds: trauma and sin. Sin is an obvious one, right? A bad choice. Any mortal sin can be a window by which the demon enters the soul, enters the house, enters the family, and so forth. That sin can be either personal, it can be cast upon someone through a curse, through some kind of a malefice, which is an object which evil has been prayed to enter in, and you leave it within the dwelling of someone. Or it can be generational. In other words, that sins, that somehow a covenant has been made with evil through the generations, and evil has been able to place itself as having a kind of dominion through those generations. How does that manifest? Well, as a priest and confessor, I see it all the time. Great-granddad was an alcoholic. Granddad was an alcoholic. Dad was an alcoholic. Now I'm an alcoholic, and I notice my son is an alcoholic. Each generation grows up in a home, for example, that may be very, very traumatic. People, and I've known people like this, that they grew up having to clean Dad's beer vomit all the time. And they grew to absolutely despise the smell of beer. Yet, they become alcoholics. Now, not every single person is like this, but there's a dominion that was formed there. And science can't explain how that exists. It just can't explain it. I think they can't explain it because it's entirely a spiritual reality. Any other questions? So that sin, trauma, I didn't explain. Any traumatic happening can be an action by which we lose faith in the goodness of God, in the goodness of the world that He created, in an awareness that there is a plan for me to unfold in this life. I'll explain that. Somebody who witnesses something very traumatic when they're young, for example, another boy, another girl getting run over by a car. That's a traumatic happening. And that trauma leaves a wound. And that wound can shake us in the goodness of reality. That the world is no longer a safe place. The world is a place where this can happen. That can leave a wound, a terrible wound within people that the devil manipulates and exacerbates. A spirit of fear can cling on to people at that point. The same thing can happen through abuse, and the most common form I see it is sexual abuse, where children are touched, are shown pornography at an age prior to pubescence, so that what they're seeing has no relationship with goodness at all in their world. They can't understand the sexual functions at all. That leaves a terrible wound. Those are one of the most common things that I deal with as somebody who performs deliverance. Any other questions? Yes.
How can you pray, ask you, in order not to go to the next generation? The other question part is, why do we need more machines? Because some people don't understand. Because for many things, we need more machines.
Right. Okay. So the question was, how do we break these generational sins? And the other question was, what is a mortal sin? I'm going to answer the second one before the first one. A mortal sin is any sin which has grave matter. So it's a serious thing you're doing. Like if you stole $2 from somebody, it's not a mortal sin. We're only talking about $2 after all. But if you stole $2,000 from somebody, that's a serious issue. You had to have done it with the knowledge that you were doing the act. So in other words, if I accidentally took the $200 or the $2,000, it's not mortal. And it has to be done with the consent of your will. In other words, there had to be nobody, for example, holding a gun to my head and saying, take that money right now and leave the bank, or I will kill you. All three conditions must be there. A serious issue, the full knowledge of its wickedness, and a deliberate choosing to do that action. That's a mortal sin. In terms of the matter, or grave matter, in terms of being a serious issue, any one of the commandments and any one of the exhortations that Jesus gave us suffices. To have a straight, a false god in our life, to use the Lord's name in vain, to not go to church on Sunday, to dishonor your father and mother, to lie, to kill, to commit adultery, and so forth, and all the different permutations of sexual sins that are out there. All of these are windows by which we invite the enemy into our souls, and he can have the dominion over us. The next question you asked was, how do we break the generational curses? You don't break them. Jesus breaks them. You're powerless. We're powerless against them. But what I do as a priest and as somebody working in deliverance is lead people to that power with Jesus. Once a kind of lack of freedom in an area where freedom should be there, right? So people should have the power to control what they do with toxic substances, right? With alcohol. Alcohol is fine in moderation, but when it's excess, when it's drunk to the point of causing drunkenness, and there's an addiction that forms, there's a freedom that we should have which is now lost. In addition to all of the human strategies that are there to eliminate that problem, right? So I am not by any means discounting AA and discounting pastoral counseling and counseling that comes through 12-step and support groups, but I am saying that you need the power of Jesus Christ to set you free. And so that has to be petitioned to Him. In other words, we have to increase our relationship with Him because He is the one that has come to undo the works of the enemy. 1 John chapter 3. We have to seek Him relentlessly in it. And sometimes it can take a long time. Why does it take a long time? Only God knows. But he wants to lead us out of darkness and into the perfection of his relationship. He is the one that we have to see. He is the one. Any other questions? Yes. Well, the first thing I would probably do is have a talk with that person and say, this looks like it could be an instance of generational sin here. So I would involve certainly a priest with that person. Right? That person needs to be ministered to in a Christian sense. Secondly, is I would pray for you as their friend, or possibly the relative, I don't know, you need to pray for a breaking of that spirit, breaking of that cycle. And to do that, the power of the rosary, having masses sent for that. The mass is an incredible weapon. It's the prayer of prayers. And so you can have a very direct influence on that. Well, here's the thing. Exorcism is not that moment where the priest comes and reads some prayers and the devil magically leaves. Exorcism is a process whereby the demon is attacked by the church. He is attacked by the church in order to weaken his hold enough on someone so that the person himself or herself can then make a decision to cast him out of himself or herself. So the person has to make a conscious decision. So you can't just bring in somebody who is dead set against losing this spirit, or is dead set against the church, or is dead set against God. It will have no effect whatsoever. All you're going to end up doing is making the demon angrier. So in your own situation, I would encourage you to invite that person to talk with a priest. Yes. Right. Okay. I don't think your first question really pertains to the topic in terms of what's the difference of a charismatic priest and a non-charismatic priest. That's outside the scope of this talk. Well, what is a charismatic priest? Every priest is charismatic. To have a charism means... Right. Again, I just think that question is outside the scope of this talk. Your latter question of how often or how prevalent exorcism is, it depends on how you define it. To use the solemn church's rite of exorcism is relatively rare. So this means that the devil has gained complete possession of the will. To perform what is called a minor exorcism, or what I call deliverance, that's very, 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 very common. There isn't a week that goes by in the States where I don't engage in some form or another of that. And it can be as simple as people are telling me their sins in the confessional, and I just see a repetitive sin coming up. And just under my breath silently, I'll say, I bind you, spirit of X. And I just notice then in subsequent confessions, is there a change going on in this person? And many, many times I found there has been. In terms of house blessings, I've already covered one example of that, but if there is sin going on in a house, that is making a covenant, making a relationship with evil. So he has the right to take up an abode there, to exist there. He has every right. He's been invited. It's only when we close that door, close that relationship, and replace it with something good, with God, that he has to leave at that point. He has to leave. Now, there are various levels of demonic influence, the least of which is temptation, to which we're all subject to, even our Lord was subject to in the desert, right? And in point of fact, our Lord's temptation in the desert is very significant, because in the Gospel of Matthew, so I'm talking about Matthew 12, chapter 30, Matthew chapter 12, verse 30. The third temptation that he describes, the devil shows our Lord all the kingdoms of the world. And he says to him, I will give you these if you bow down and worship me. Now what is interesting, as much as what our Lord says in reply, is what he does not say in reply. Elsewhere in the scriptures, he defines the devil as a liar and the father of lies. And that when he lies, he's only acting in character, and he repeats again, because he's a liar and the father of lies. But he doesn't call him a liar when the devil makes this offer to him. Why doesn't he call him a liar? Because the devil wasn't lying. The kingdoms were under his possession. The kingdom, the world belongs to him through that act of Adam. Adam chose to have a relationship with him. And that had massive implications for the entire universe, including ourselves. We were born with the effects of that single action that Adam undertook. Any time we flirt with evil, we flirt with darkness, we make a movement towards that which we shouldn't, that which is not life-giving, that which is not part of God's plan, we are forming a covenant with evil. Right? You can replace covenant with any other word you want. We're forming a marriage with evil. We're forming a friendship with evil. That kind of relationship gives rights and jurisdiction to the other over ourselves, right? When you make a friend with somebody, when somebody becomes your friend, then that person has a relationship with you. You would tolerate that person in your house, whereas you probably wouldn't tolerate a perfect stranger. This is the same with evil. It is a parallel instance in the spiritual realm. Temptation is the lowest level of demonic influence. And then come things like addiction. Now, not every addiction is an instance of the enemy. So please don't go away calling your father who smokes somebody who's under the influence of the devil because of it. But he can cause addiction. He can cause obsession, where somebody is obsessed with something or someone, where that person can't get that issue out of their mind, can't get that person out of their mind, is not free in an area in which they should be free. Then oppression. Now, in oppression, the devil begins to control the memory and the imagination. So things that happened in the past, they can't remember accurately. And things that didn't happen, he places those memories and those thoughts in the mind. Oppression and possession, one kind of merges into the other. When that happens is a matter of debate. Theologians have debated that for centuries. But suffice it to say that once somebody is in a level of oppression, the demon is already acting through their bodies and through parts of their mind. The goal, of course, is to get the will. And once the demon possesses the will, he begins acting fully through the body of the person. And I've certainly seen this happen. I've certainly seen many voices speaking through the mouth of a person. I've seen a girl who was 14 years old throw men around as if they were rag dolls. Throw big, strong Texas men around, football players, as if they were just absolutely nothing. But then respond to the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, stand still. And she stands perfectly still. This is the power that just the name of Jesus has. Now you think about that next time you go say, you know, "Oh my God." Or you say the name of Jesus Christ in an instance when it's not appropriate, where you're not using it in a context that is reverent. This reality really does exist, and it begins through a covenant with evil. It begins through a covenant with evil. I'll tell you another case that I had. I was in a city within the United States, and there was a professional, and I'm not going to name his profession, but let's just say he was a very high-ranking civil servant, who was in his 30s and decided to go back to confession because he wanted to start going to church again. He had gotten married, his wife had joined a prayer group, and she experienced a conversion, and she had been working on him and saying, "You know, it's about time we start going to church." And he said, "You know, you're right." But he knew he had to go to confession before he could receive the Blessed Sacrament. When he walked into the church, he fell on the floor writhing and screaming, and multiple voices were coming out of his mouth. Now, that drew the priest out of the confessional, as you can understand. And the priest started to pray with him, and it seemed to make things worse, which is not surprising. When the devil is attacked and is pressed, especially with the name of Jesus, he's going to react. And so he called us up and he said, "I'm sending somebody over to see you." And so I remember I answered the door, and this person was, he was about my age, and he was perfectly calm when I let him in. And we led him into a room, and we were sitting with him, and on our shelves we kept a glass with like a drinking glass with water. It looks like, you know, you drank maybe half of your water and you put the rest on your bookcase. Well, what he didn't know is that that's holy water. And so one of the tests that is required to prove an instance of possession is that there has to be the following three things. Knowledge of the occult, so knowledge of things that are hidden. 2, an extreme aversion to any religious signs or symbols. 3, strength that is beyond the human capacity of the person. And so what we did was we were engaging him in a dialogue, and in one of these instances when he was looking at somebody and engaged, one of the priests dipped his finger in that holy water and went behind him so he couldn't see. This was as the priest was passing by, and flicked it on his clothing. So he didn't flick it on any exposed part of his skin, so that there is no human way that he could feel. He shot out of that chair as if hot acid was poured down his back. And now it's on. I mean, you've proved that there's a presence here of something that is not natural. There is no way he could have known that that holy water was sprinkled on. There is no way. There is no way. And so thus began then the process of liberation, whereby we need now to find the door by which the demon entered. Now, when the man was still lucid, before the demon was provoked to act out in him, he explained something that happened when he was young. He was 7 years old, and it's just like the story behind the movie The Exorcism. Someone came over with a Ouija board and offered to allow him to play that, and he did. And he remembered that at night that there was a black figure that entered his room, and he described the face. He actually drew a picture, and he said the figure was so black that although the rest of his room was dark, there was no lights on. He was so black that it made the rest of the room seem like it was daylight. And that thing made an offer to him. And the offer was that he would gain powerful strength in exchange for, and he named something, and it was a something that the child didn't understand. But he agreed to the offer, and he remembers sensing him go inside him, in through his stomach. And from that night, he suffered nightmares frequently. And as he grew older, he became incredibly strong. And eventually, even when he was this civil servant in society, he would find himself, okay, well, today is a Tuesday. He would wake up and all of a sudden it's now Friday. He wakes up on the other side of town with his shirt off and his body is bruised all over. He has no idea what he has done. So this is what I mean by he is missing freedom in an area where he should be free. Now, to get him free was going to be obviously to renounce at least this act. I don't know if there were any others involved, but we knew that there was this act. And as we were talking to him and saying, I'm going to call him Jack. Jack, you need to renounce that act that you did. So repeat after me, in the name of Jesus. And then he would begin to say it and the demon would come forward. And then there was expletives that were uttered and insults against us, the priests, and so forth. And this went on for a couple of hours. But eventually, we weakened the demon enough with prayers that he could say the name of Jesus. When he said that single word, he didn't even have enough strength at that point to utter a full sentence, but he said the name of Jesus, and it ended immediately. This is the power of even just the name of Jesus. And I can't emphasize enough, remember that the next time that you use the name of God in an irreverent way. You see, you have a name, and I have a name, but God is his name. And his name causes all of hell to shudder and tremble. Any other questions? Yes. I'm sorry, I can't hear you, sir. So I'm going to repeat your question, and if I don't get it right, please inform me. So the statement was that this is understandable with people who have evil in their lives, who are flirting with evil. In other words, the attack of the enemy, the evil one. But this also happens to people who are living holy lives. So, for example, St. John Vianney. It absolutely does, but there is a difference. And the difference is the attack on St. John Vianney is external to himself. The attack with people who are flirting with sin or who have inherited generational sin is internal to themselves. There is a part of themselves that is compromised. St. John Vianney had an outstanding attitude towards evil. It was wonderful. He didn't give it a higher place than it ought to have. And what do I mean by that? I believe the very first time that the devil manifested himself to St. John Vianney was in a chair that he had in his rectory. And St. John walked into that room, was walking past that room into another one, and looks over and sees the devil sitting in the chair. And he laughed at him. He laughed at the devil. And the devil said to him, "You laugh at me?" And he looked at him and he said, "I'm a baptized Christian. You ought to be terrorized by me." And what he did was he took holy water and traced the sign of the cross on every window and door that he had in his rectory. In other words, he sealed the devil inside. And he started to praise God. And the devil was screaming in torment and begged him to be released. That's the power of the enemy. He has power if you surrender to him. If you don't, then he has none. At another time, I know that he stood, while St. John Vianney was sleeping, he stood on his bed, and that woke him up, and he looked up, and he said to him, "Oh, it's you. I thought it was an earthquake." And he turned over and he went back to sleep. He had the perfect attitude. The perfect attitude. You do not surrender any more power to him than what he has. And what he has from the beginning is nothing but the power of temptation. That's the only power. He has the power of suggestion to make an offer. And as long as we don't succumb to that offer, he has no more power than that. Yes. Oh, yes. So you're referring to the scripture of when a demon leaves a man, it wanders through arid wastelands. Is that the one you're talking about? Right. So when a demon leaves a place, a person, or an object, our Lord describes, and this appears, I believe, both in the Gospel of Matthew and in Luke. Our Lord says that he wanders through dry places or arid wastelands. In other words, a place in which there is no life. And seeking comfort but finding none. In other words, it's very painful for the demon when he leaves where he was. That he turns around and tries to go back from where he came. And if he can enter that place, he does, and he brings with him seven demons more powerful than himself, such that the second state of the person is worse than the first. And this bears out in my life with pastorally and dealing with people, in that if people are not serious about replacing their bad habits with good ones, replacing their relationships with evil, and that can be in the form of what they watch on television, what they do on the internet, what they choose to invest their money in terms of entertainment, any sins whatsoever. If a lifestyle is not corrected, then he's going to come back. And he's going to come back stronger than he ever was. So for that reason, when I'm in confession, and I told you that, if I hear certain behaviors, I'm listening to what the person is telling me, and I'm listening inside to what I'm sensing, and I'll bind a certain spirit, a spirit of abuse, I bind you. If I hear that as a frequent sin that this person is confessing, but I never cast him out. I never cast him out because the person may not want him cast out. And if I do that, that person may get in a worse state. Me intervening too strongly can expose that person if his or her lifestyle is not appropriate to greater attack. So I bind, I chain him in his power, but I don't cast him out unless they desire it. What happened to the demons in the pigs in Scripture? When our Lord cast them out of the Gerasene demoniac? That's a good question. I've wondered that myself. Certainly, one interpretation that has been put forward for that is that the demons in the Gerasene demoniac were encountering God himself, their creator. And if you notice, when our Lord approached the Gerasene demoniac, the demons could do nothing but speak the truth. They were already under a power of God. And so they asked, you know, please don't release us into the arid wastelands, release us into that herd of pigs. But their behavior is so dysfunctional. Right? The demons are dysfunction itself, dysfunction personified. That the pigs, once they reached in them, they just couldn't control themselves. And so they did They did something foolish, something self-destructive, which annihilated even their second home. Yes.
You were saying earlier, obviously the reason for possession in a human being is to take the will.
Right.
And I can understand possession of a place, because if you're possessing a home, then you can get to the people and their will.
Right.
But what would be the purpose of possessing an object?
The same thing, right? To possess, and there's different forms of that. So one is a cursed object. And they're able to carry the power of evil. So one of the priests that I work with, I found an amulet that had been hidden in his office. So I was looking at some books that he had on a shelf, and I saw an amulet of, what the Hispanics call Santa Muerte, Holy Death. They have a devotion to the Grim Reaper, because that's what the image is. Well, that's a cursed object. That is an incantation. In other words, a prayer of evil has been said over it, summoning the devil to work within that object. It's the evil equivalent of, like, say, a miraculous medal, or a St. Benedict medal, or having a rosary blessed, or that kind of thing. It's the counterfeit equivalent in order to give evil access into a place. Yes? Oh, I wouldn't say that. I work very hard. That's what I do.
Okay, but now priests, I have this gift on the body. How do we get to you, or how do we get deliverance from something we feel truly?
Well, what you have to do is approach your local pastor. I'm not open for business in this diocese. I have enough problems of my own. You need to go to your pastor. If you need to listen to him, because oftentimes I would say a good third of the cases that come into my office, they're people that are schizophrenic, they're paranoid, or they're people that are just mistaken, and you know, they say, well, gosh, Father, this is my third cold in 2 months. Can you say an exorcism over me and drive the devil out of me? It's just foolish, right? So you need to listen to him. If you've presented your case to him logically, and he cannot help you, then you need to call your diocese. And if this is your diocese, you need to call the chancery in Hamilton and state that you have this pastoral need. But at a certain point, you're going to have to listen to the decision and judgment of the church. Right? And there are many, the world is filled with many people who go around looking for an exorcism, and it's not an exorcism they need. In fact, I have a questionnaire that I give people. Anybody whom the diocese refers to, I'm talking about my own diocese, or other priests do, or so forth, I whisk out a 7-page questionnaire that they have to fill out. And basically, it goes into a lot of personal and intimate areas of their life. And I say that you need to fill this out honestly and fully, because I want to see what kind of relationships you have now and what kind of relationships you've had in the past. I want to see where your sins have been. What have you done? And they need to be perfectly frank about that. Otherwise, it just doesn't work. But I sneak in one question in that questionnaire. Are you being followed? If they check yes, I don't bother reading any further. They're a schizophrenic case. Followed. Yeah. When somebody is harassed by evil, it is an internal thing. They describe, when they come and describe things to me, they're shameful. They're embarrassed as I'll get out to talk about what the things that they're doing. They'll say, Father, you're going to say I'm crazy, but right, the ones that are crazy never say that. Right? And I don't want to belittle people with mental illness, right? But they can think that they're under the power of the evil one, because there's things out there to get them, right? The devil's trying, and that's just not what occurs. So the people who are suffering from it genuinely have behaviors that they're doing, and they're consciously doing them, but they can't not do them. And so those are the people that can be helped. Like that's potentially a spiritual issue. The rest, in terms of chemical imbalance and stuff, well, that's the domain of medicine, not of an exorcist, not of a priest who is assisting in the ministry of deliverance. Anyone else? Yes.
When you go to Father, you're afraid of seeing and taking things like advertising, right? In the business, you may have a profession.
Well, nobody's perfect, brother. That's a tough one to answer. And I would answer it differently on different days. It's very good to be aware of how the universe is constructed, right? How the state of the universe as it is, because that empowers us. But there's always going to be a group of people that love to be tantalized by the devil and by dark things and by the workings of evil, and they're intrigued by that. They find that entertaining. And those people can cause a lot of trouble to themselves. And so I don't like to provoke that. That being said, though, there is a genuine pastoral need when people are under the power of the evil one. And so we have to minister to those people. I'm going to give you another example. I was at a Men's Day conference in, it was being held at within a city within Texas. And so I sat and was hearing confessions all day long, and a man came to me, and his wife had left him. And so he was describing that, and he was so filled with anger as to how, you know, she did terrible things to him in the marriage and then finally left him. He's shaking, and I can just see the rage in him. And I asked him, well, how long ago did this happen? And he said, 2 years ago, Father. Now, 2 years ago, and you still have, so this is me thinking, and you still have this amount of rage? I mean, 2 weeks ago, I could understand, but 2 years, you haven't moved on? It's unnatural. And so what I did was I told him the story of, for those of you that were here for the relic exposition, the story of Maria Goretti, which is a story of the triumph of forgiveness. And I described to him and showed him the beauty and the power of forgiveness and how God can take hold of a situation that is extremely ugly and completely reverse it through the act of forgiveness. And so he was very moved by the story of the saint, and he said, okay, yes. So that God can do something beautiful in my life and in hers, I forgive her. And so I led him through a series of renunciations. And then, so I said to him, repeat after me, in the name of Jesus, I release my wife from the debt that she owes me. I release her from the hurt that she's done to me. I release her from the rage that I have towards her. I choose not to have any rage. So he's just repeating everything. Finally, when he was done, I said, okay, now you just sit back, and if you don't mind, I'm going to put my hands on your head and pray for you. Would you permit me to do that? And he said, sure, Father. So I put my hands on his head, and all I did, my prayer, was just one of praising God. God, you're wonderful. I thank you for this man. I thank you for creating him. I thank you for the ways in which you've gifted him, that you've empowered him. Lord, you're the source. As I'm doing this, and I'm doing it under my breath, he can't hear me. Every muscle in that man's head was shaking. It felt like every muscle was just swimming under my fingers. And he begins to shake, and I just continue. And after, I would say, about 2 minutes or 3 minutes, it started to lessen, and within about 20 or 30 seconds, there was a complete stop. When that happened, he looked up at me, and it was as if he had just been hit by a bird in midair. And he said to me, "What was that?" And I said, "Brother, that was demons leaving. And they're going to want to come back, because you just had a physical manifestation going on. There was a part of you that was being the host to something you didn't want. It's going to want to come back, because our Lord prophesies that in the scriptures. So whenever you sense the anger, and the anger is going to come at you feeling like it's internal, right? You're going to feel the rage, and it's going to feel like you've never gotten rid of it. But that's an illusion, it's a lie, it's a temptation. You need to say, you need to renounce it in just the ways in which we've done. Turn to it, say, I've renounced you, I don't want you, you don't belong in me. And then turn to God and say, Lord, come and fill me with your presence. Fill in the space that this thing is trying to get into. And if you have to do that 50 times a day, then do it, because it will, over time, stop. The enemy will see that it cannot access the doorway anymore. You've cemented it shut through prayer. Yes. The dangers of? Well, it's very difficult to define the New Age. It's very difficult. But anything that talks about things having energy, I'm very suspicious of. I'm very suspicious of. That goes against a Christian cosmology. It goes against a Christian worldview. Things are created and they're good, but they don't have a power that could be described as in some sense magical, or in some sense raising your own energy level up to a certain degree. I advise people to run as fast as they can from that sort of thing. That being said, many people practice yoga. And many people do it for exercise. And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. Many people practice meditation that is similar to the way a Buddhist would practice. Similar. But their object is God. So it's different. It's a different kind of thing. It's not mixed with the principles of Buddhism. It's meditation that may physically resemble a Buddhist meditation. But their object is not nothingness. Their object is God. And so that is fine. So I hesitate to give a blanket statement that anything that anyone calls New Age is evil. But I get very, very conservative when things are when inanimate objects and energies are given a higher place than what they deserve. Does that answer your question? I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. The best defense is to live the sacramental life of the church. The seven sacraments are the seven ways Jesus Christ left to heal the world. They are the ways by which we have been redeemed and are sustained to reach heaven. One good confession, one thorough sacramental confession, is better than 100 exorcisms. One reception of the Eucharist in love always wounds the devil eternally. Every time somebody receives our Lord in love, the devil is wounded for eternity and is reminded of the place that he lost in heaven. So the sacramental life of the church is indispensable. You have to pray, right? So notice that what I've been going into is relationship. The sin of Adam caused relationships to be perverted. And Christ has reached out in an attempt to form a relationship with us, to which we're free to agree or not agree. If we choose to have a relationship with that which is evil, or even for that matter, that which is not God, right? That which is not goodness itself, explicitly God even, then we are going against God. And I wrote that, "He who is not for me is against me." Matthew chapter 12, verse 30. He who is not for me is against me. So we have no choice but to engage in an active prayer life. We have no choice. Now, among these, daily Mass is the best practice. A second is a rosary. And a third, or maybe it's co-equal with the rosary, is Eucharistic adoration. Now, I of course, in and of itself, adoration is better than adoring the Lord, our Lord in the Eucharist, is better than praying the rosary. But many people, because of their professional life and their home life, can't make it to adoration. But they can pray a rosary as they're cleaning the house, as they're at work on the assembly line, and so forth. So that's a very good practice. To introduce the Mother of God into your prayer life is such a grace. I have never seen the devil react with more fury than when the name of Mary was mentioned. I mean, he reacts with more fury, typically, than even when the name of Jesus is mentioned. The name of Jesus has power over him, but the name of Mary just causes him to writhe. And a good friend of mine, who is an exorcist, describes how, in one case he was working on, internally, the priest was starting to pray the Memorare, "Remember, O Most Gracious Virgin Mary, that never was known." And the demon said to him, "No, anyone but her. Anyone but her." That's telling you volumes, right? Oh, that bothers you, does it, Mr. Demon? Hold your breath. I'm sorry, I didn't hear any of that. No, Mary is not over Jesus. And that's not what I'm implying. I'm not implying Mary is over Jesus. But what I'm saying is that he has a particular disgust for her. It's a particular hatred. He doesn't have more fear. He has a particular disgust. If I said that, let me change my words. He has a particular disgust. And he fears her too. Does he fear her more than Jesus? No. The what? Sorry? The labyrinth. I don't know. I don't know, to be honest, much about labyrinths. It's just outside the scope of this talk, I think, that question. I'm going to take one more question, and I think we're going to bring the evening to a close. Yes. When I'm binding, I'm limiting the power of the evil one. So I always say a statement, "In the name of Jesus, I bind you." So if I hear a kind of, certain people, it's almost as if they're wearing, for example, a sign that says, "Kick me," all their lives. They're targets of abuse. They're targets of manipulation. It's easy for people to do bad things against them. They're easy people to ignore when they walk in a room. So a spirit of abuse may be on those people. Maybe on. And so if I sense somebody is suffering from something repetitive like that, then I'll just make the statement under my breath. The person never hears it. "But I bind you, spirit of abuse." If he's there, he's bound. If he's not there, there's no damage done. So in confession, I'm kind of always listening and trying to discern patterns and trying to intervene if and when it seems necessary. Okay? So thank you very much for coming. I hope you have at least a little bit of a clearer picture as to what an exorcism is, which is an assisting of the person to renounce the power of evil in their lives. That's what an exorcism is. It's not some magical process by which some prayers are uttered and everything is returned to peace and tranquility. There are many people who need exorcisms and want to get them to be free of certain effects that they're suffering in their life, but they don't want to change their lifestyle. And those are the people that, you know, if I could eliminate those people out of my life, the people that don't really want to change, then I would free up about 25% of my time. So, thank you very much. The Lord be with you.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.